Well, hello everybody, and welcome to our 10th season of ABC Drama. We're so glad that all of you could make it out tonight, or well, this afternoon actually, so thank you for coming. This play is free, but I just want to let you know of a donation box in the back if you are led to give a few dollars or something to our cause here. There will be an intermission between Act 1 and Act 2. We ask that you let the thespians go out and use the water closet, also known as the restroom, first. And then after that is done, you can also as well go and use the restroom if you need to, get a drink of water. Oh yes, and also before we start tonight, let's just say a word in prayer, so bow with me if you will. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day that you've given to all of us. I thank you for these people that you've brought here to be able to enjoy this afternoon with us. We pray that you would make this a productive afternoon, that we can enjoy each other and enjoy the entertainment. We pray that you would help everything to go smoothly and well, that you would be with every one of us, and just give us a really fun afternoon. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please enjoy the show.
Attention! Attention! Passengers of the Lusitania! Our ship has been hit by a torpedo that we believe was launched by a German submarine. We are evacuating women and children to lifeboats now.
Why is this happening, Captain?
We've crossed into the waters around Great Britain. Germany has declared these waters a war zone and, in retaliation, fired upon our vessel. Now, come along with me and I'll get you safely to a lifeboat.
I beg your pardon.
Oh, I didn't see you there.
I'm sorry for that. It's just that I need your help with a matter of great urgency.
I'm sure it can wait until we reach the shore. We have to get off this boat before it sinks.
I'm afraid I may not make it off this boat alive.
But...
there's no time. You're American, is that right?
I am.
A patriotic one?
Of course I am.
Please, don't be offended. You don't know how much is at stake, but I've got to trust someone, and it must be a woman.
Why?
Because they're only putting women and children onto the lifeboats, and I have something that needs to make it ashore. I'm carrying papers, vitally important. They will change the progress of the war for the Allies. These papers have got to be saved. They've got a better chance with you than with me. Will you take them?
I will.
Wait. There's a chance I have been followed. I don't think I have, but one never knows. If so, there will be danger. Are you sure you want to go through with this?
I'll go through with it, all right. What do I do with the papers once I reach the shore?
Watch the newspapers. I'll advertise in the personal column of the Times, beginning with the title, Shitney. Is there no word from me within 3 days? Well, you know I didn't make it off this boat alive. You should then take the papers to the American Embassy and deliver them to the ambassador's own hands. Is that clear?
Quite clear.
Then be ready. I'm going to say goodbye. Goodbye, and good luck.
Ah, there you are. The last of the women and children are boarding the lifeboats now. The Lusitania is sinking fast. We must go.
All right, good.
Come along now.
That's odd.
Tuppence, old bean!
Tommy, old thing!
Well, I have not seen you since we encountered each other, what was it? 3 years ago in that old army hospital. How is my favorite nurse?
A nurse no longer, I'm afraid.
Did that hospital close down just like everything else now that the war is over?
I'm afraid so. What about you? What's a former lieutenant in the Queen's army doing now that his fighting days are behind him?
Well, I was discharged 2 months ago, and I've spent my time since spending my army pay. Now, let's sit down in this cafe and we'll catch up properly.
You just admitted to me that you're broke. How do you expect to pay for your meal?
Well, I have a few shillings left, but I wouldn't mind if an old friend would treat me to lunch.
Oh, Tommy Beresford, you are the same boy I've known since grade school. A whole lot of charm and not a lot of sense. Can't you see? I'm not any better off than you. I've tried finding a job doing anything, but I haven't had any luck.
Well, let's at least sit down and order some tea. Or is that too rich for your purse?
Suppose I can spare a few shillings.
And would you believe it? She actually cried when I told her she couldn't have the flat after all.
You don't say.
Funny bits of conversation one overhears when passing by. Just this morning, I overheard two people talking about someone named Jane Finn in the most angry manner.
Jane Finn? That's an interesting name, isn't it?
What'll it be?
I believe we'll both have some tea and buttered toast.
And make sure the tea comes in separate pots. I want to make sure we're each getting what we paid for.
Oh, yeah, a couple who is clearly rolling in money. Lucky me.
Well, let's catch up. You mentioned you've been looking for work since the end of the war. In what line of work are you seeking employment?
I've tried everything. I did have a job driving around delivery trucks. Oh, and I once had a position driving around a general in the army.
What a waste of money. The government lets us lowly lieutenants go around with nothing but a few pounds to our names. And the generals, well, they're driven all around town by beautiful girls.
What was that? Did you just call me beautiful?
What? I don't know what you're talking about. Oh, look, our tea. What timing. You have earned yourself a fine gratuity at this table.
A gratuity on two slices of buttered toast and tea? How very kind of you.
Yes, well, I worked in a government office for a short while, and have since then looked into becoming a land girl, a postwoman, and a bus conductress. But nothing's turned up.
My story is pretty much the same. There just aren't any jobs. I'm just about desperate.
So am I. I've hung on as long as I can, but I think I may have to go home to my parents.
Well, don't you want to?
Of course I don't. I like living in London. I don't want to go back, but, oh, Tommy, what else is there to do? Money, money, money. I think about money morning, noon, and night.
Same here.
There are three ways to get money. Inherit it, marry it, or make it. The first is ruled out, as I don't have any rich elderly relatives. And I've tried being a millionaire, but I haven't had any luck.
So, you're looking for a husband, are you?
Well, marriage is my best option. I've made up my mind to marry a man with money. Any smart girl would. Besides, I'm not one to trifle with sentimental feelings where love is concerned.
Well, I couldn't agree more. Besides, who needs love when you have money?
So if I can't inherit money, and I can't marry money, then it remains that I must make money.
We've tried that, and failed.
We've tried all the orthodox ways, but suppose we try the unorthodox. Let's be adventurers.
Adventurers? Well, it has a nice ring to it, doesn't it? How do we begin?
That's the hard part. We might attract the wrong sort of client who would hire us to kill someone for them.
Well, that's delightful. Coming from a clergyman's daughter, it would be funny if you got caught.
I wouldn't likely get caught. I'm terribly clever.
And just as modest as you were in grade school.
Don't tease. Now, should we really do it, Tommy? Should we become adventurers?
A joint venture of sorts?
That's it. We could call our company the Young Adventurers Limited.
And how do we get in touch with would-be employers?
We take out an advertisement. It could read, "Two young adventurers for hire, willing to do anything or go anywhere. Pay must be good. No unreasonable offer refused." How would that strike you if you read it?
It would strike me as a hoax or otherwise written by a lunatic.
I've read worse. Why don't you head on over to the Times now and submit it? I expect it will cost 5 shillings, so here's a half crown for my share.
To our joint venture, and may it prosper.
The Young Adventurers Limited.
Well, I suppose I'd best be off then. Good day, Tuppence. What a great fortune I ran into you today.
Take care, old thing. I'll just finish my tea and then I'll be off.
Excuse me, but may I speak to you for a moment?
I suppose so. How can I help you?
Actually, I think I may be of some use to you.
In what way?
My name is Edwina Whittington, and I own Estonia Glassware, located just over there. I overheard your conversation with that young man, and I think I may have a job for you. What would you say to £100 now and all expenses paid?
And the nature of the work?
A simple task, really. Nothing more than a pleasant trip to Paris.
Oh my! For how long?
Possibly 3 months. I need you to enroll in a girls' school by the name of Madame Plombier's. You're so young and beautiful. I'm sure you could pass for a girl of 16.
Why, thank you. Are there any conditions?
None whatsoever. You'd go in character as my ward, and you wouldn't be able to communicate with your friends here. I'd have to request absolute secrecy for the time being.
Very well. And what will Mr. Beresford be doing while I'm playing at being a schoolgirl?
Mr. Beresford?
My partner, the young man I was with.
Ah, yes. I'm afraid we won't be requiring his services.
In that case, I'm afraid we don't have a deal. It's both of us or neither of us. Good day, Miss Winton.
Wait. Maybe we can work something out, Miss... I didn't catch your name.
Jane Finn.
So that's your little game, is it?
Whatever do you mean?
Been playing a game with me this whole time, have you? A little cat and mouse? It appears you knew all along what I wanted from you, and yet you kept playing your part. Who's been blabbing? Rita?
No. Rita knows nothing about me.
And yet you knew to come here and say the name Jane Finn. How much do you know?
It could be my own name, or perhaps I hit upon it by chance.
Quit fooling. How much do you know, and how much do you want?
My dear Mrs. Whittington, let us lay all of our cards on the table. I have knowledge of a certain name, so suppose you would say I'd like a little something now, and we can continue this conversation in your office with Mr. Beresford present.
Blackmail.
Of course not. Let's just call it payment of services in advance.
Dear, I thought you were just a meek little girl with enough brains for my purpose.
Life is full of surprises.
All the same, someone's been talking. Here's £50 now. Meet me at my office later in Estonia Glassware with your partner, and we'll talk.
Good day, Mrs. Whittington. Or should I say, au revoir?
Au revoir, indeed.
Well, I do hope Tommy returns soon.
So, you wanted to see me again, eh?
Of course I did. Look at this.
What did you do, rob a bank?
Hardly. I may have gotten us a lead on a job.
What kind of job?
I'm not quite sure. There seems to be some sort of mystery here. Curiously enough, when I gave the false name of Jane Finn, a potential business client became quite angry with me. And to think, I only just invented that name to conceal my own.
But you didn't just invent it. I told it to your tea, remember? I ever heard two people talking about Jane Finn?
Yes, I remember now. How extraordinary. Tommy, who did those two people look like? The ones who you heard talking about Jane Finn?
One was a medium-heighted woman, stern-looking. I believe she had dark hair.
That's her, Whittington, the woman who offered me a job.
Look here, Tuppence. What happened at this meeting with Whittington?
Nothing, really. She approached me and asked me if I'd be interested in a job in Paris for a few months. When I gave the false name of Jane Finn, she accused me of blackmail. Then she gave me this money for now and said to meet her in her office in that building once I had found you. That's odd. I'm sure she said it was that building.
Let's have a look, shall we? Excuse me. We have a meeting here with the proprietors of Estonian Glassware this afternoon. But I see you have put up a notice stating that this building is for lease.
Ah, yes, the former tenants moved out of here quickly. Almost as if they were in a hurry.
I should say so! We only just set up that meeting a few moments ago.
Well, I've been a landlord for 20 years and seen some odd things in my day. But the characters who just vacated this building were a troubling bunch. They paid me an extra 6 months' rent. So who am I to go sticking my nose where it's not wanted?
I suppose you're right. Do you happen to remember the name that was on the lease?
It was signed by Mr. Brown, I believe.
Thank you for your time.
Good day.
Well, I suppose that's it then.
Not quite. Don't forget we still have our advertisement.
Yes, I had forgotten about that. But in light of recent developments, perhaps we should add an addendum to that advertisement.
And what will it say?
How about this? Wanted. Any information regarding Jane Finn. Contact the young adventurers.
I think we're onto something here, Tuppence. A real-life adventure. And our first clue is the mysterious Jane Finn.
advertisement regarding Jane Finn.
I know. The first is from Mr. Carter, and the second from Mr. Julius P. Hersheimer.
Oh, I'm so excited I can hardly stand it. But I do wish you would have let me set up at least one of the meetings. We are partners, you know.
I know. But we don't know who we're dealing with here. So I thought it would be best if I set up the first meetings. Speaking of which, the first is with Mr. Carter. Oh, and I bet that's him over there.
Ah, there you are, Mr. Beresford. I didn't realize you wanted to meet in such a public place. Couldn't we go to your office?
Our office is, under construction. I'm afraid we're going to have to meet here. And this is my partner, Miss Tuppence Cowley.
How do you do?
Well, if we must meet here, then let us be brief. I believe I have a job for you two. You see, I work with some very important people in the government who are looking for the very woman you advertised about.
Jane Finn.
You seem to know the name well.
Well, Tommy overheard two people using in conversation the other day. And just this morning, I mentioned it in passing to a potential business client, and she nearly exploded with rage. It seems she thought I was mixed up in this Jane Finn business already.
And the name of the woman you were meeting with?
Mrs. Edwina Whittington. At least, I think that was her name. When we went to inquire after her at the Estonia Glassware, which she claimed to own, it was empty. The landlord said that it had been a Mr. Brown to sign the lease.
Mr. Brown, of course. Well, it seems you're involved in this mystery already, so you might as well get paid for it. How does a moderate salary and all expenses paid sound?
It sounds wonderful. What would we have to do?
Oh, that's simple. Find Jane Finn.
Yes, but who is Jane Finn?
I suppose you're entitled to know certain information, but your involvement in these matters must remain strictly unofficial. If you get yourselves into trouble, I will not be able to help you. And these are dangerous people we are dealing with. Do you understand?
We understand.
Very well. It all began with a secret document, a treaty that was being delivered to England aboard the Lusitania during the war in 1915. It was carried by a messenger named Danvers, who wore it in an oilskin packet next to his body. As the Lusitania approached British soil, it was torpedoed by the Germans and sank. Danvers did not make it out alive.
How terrible!
What we have since learned is that Danvers was last seen talking to an American girl shortly before the ship sank. That girl was Jane Finn. We believe Danvers passed the treaty on to her so that it would make its way to British soil. Only women and children made it onto the lifeboats, you see. Unfortunately, no one has heard from Jane Finn since that day, 4 years ago.
But why would anyone want the treaty now? The war is over.
It seems that the contents of the treaty would be embarrassing for many of those in our government. As you know, there's been quite a bit of unrest among the Labor Party and working class since the war ended. And the Bolsheviks in Russia are looking for any chance sign of weakness here. If the treaty were to surface, the Bolsheviks would have what they need and use the labor unrest to overthrow the British government.
Can this be true?
It can and is. Bolshevik gold is pouring into this country for the purpose of starting a revolution. And there's a certain man working behind the scenes for his own purposes.
And who is that?
We don't know. We only know him by the name Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown? That was the man Whittington was associated with. That must be why she got so angry when I mentioned the name Jane Finn.
Indeed. Seems you're involved in this already. So can we make it official? Can the Young Adventurers Limited succeed where so many before you have failed? Can you find Jane Finn?
We can certainly try.
Well, try hard and quickly. The fate of the British government is in your hands.
Oh, pinch me, Tommy! Pinch me! I can't believe this is really happening!
Well, if you say so.
Ow! I didn't really want you to pinch me.
Well, the next time, don't tell me to pinch you. I always take you at your word.
Our joint venture has officially begun. Now, what time are we expecting Mr. Hersheimer?
Right now. And I'll bet you anything that's him over there. Mr. Hersheimer?
Tommy Beresford, is that you?
Indeed it is. And this is my partner, Miss Tuppence Cowley.
You can call me Julius. Now, you nice folks told me to meet you out here. Tell me what you can about my cousin.
Your cousin?
Jane Finn.
Then you know where she is?
No! Darned if I do. Don't you?
We advertise to receive information about Jane Finn, not to give it.
Now, you know, I may talk funny to you, proper English folks, but I can read. I just thought maybe you were after her history, and that you might know where she is now. Unless you're the ones who've got her, and you mean to do her harm if I refuse.
We haven't kidnapped your cousin. We were the ones hired to try to find her.
I suppose that's all right, then.
When was the last time you saw your cousin?
Oh, I've never seen her.
What?
No, sir. You see, my father and her mother, they were brother and sister, but they had a sort of a, falling out, and my father made a pile of money, but he refused to give her any when she married a very, very poor school teacher.
I see.
So when he died last fall, he left me heaps upon heaps of money. I decided to set things right, and I set about trying to find my cousin. So I tracked her down and came over here, only to find out that no one has heard from her in more than 4 years.
Thank you for your candor. We'll let you know if we find anything.
Wait. No, don't leave. You see, I mean for us to work together. I have piles of money and nothing but time, and I just have to find my cousin Jane.
Julia Sorsheimer?
Yes?
I'm Inspector Jack from Scotland Yard. I was told you had a photograph you wanted to give us in connection with the missing persons case you filed a few days ago.
Oh, yes, sir. That was a photograph of my cousin Jane. Only, I gave my only copy to one of your men a few hours ago.
I'm afraid to tell you this, but, Scotland Yard did not send anyone to your hotel room to retrieve the photograph. Do you remember the name of the officer you spoke to earlier?
Yes, I do. No, sir, I don't. Oh, wait, no, yes, it was on his card. It was a Mr. Brown. A very quiet, unassuming sort of chap.
Mr. Brown?
Thank you, Mr. Hershammer. We will do our best to get some more of this.
Well, this is terrible. That was my only photograph of Cousin Jane. Now what am I going to do?
We're going to get to the bottom of this, that's what. You may have just given us a clue. We think a mysterious man named Mr. Brown may be behind Jane's disappearance.
Wait, but Mr. Brown was the name of the inspector who came by my hotel room.
Precisely. It's unlikely we'll be able to get to Mr. Brown very easily. Therefore, it may be best if we track down on some of his associates.
I've already met one of his associates, Mrs. Whittington. She knows what I look like, so it may not be best if I were the one to track her down.
Leave Whittington to Julius and I. Did she mention any other names?
Only one. Rita. Whittington thought that Rita might be the one blabbing about Jane Finn.
Well, I don't see what good that does us. What do you suppose we do? Put out another advertisement? It could read, Wanted. Female crook. Answers by the name Rita.
I don't think that'll be necessary. You see, I think I know it's Rita you're referring to.
You do?
Oh, don't act surprised. You see, I told you I came out here with the intention of finding my cousin Jane, and I plan to spare no expense until I've done just that. So, I hired a private investigator. He didn't give me much, only a folder with a few names and places in it. But one of those names was a Miss Rita Vandermeyer. Her real name is Marguerite.
This case is just filled with interesting coincidences, isn't it, Tommy?
I'd say so. It's as if we were meant to be on this case.
I'll track down her address. Perhaps she'll give me some answers, woman to woman.
That's a fine idea. Julius and I will track down Whittington.
Take care, old thing. Wouldn't want anything to happen to you.
Wait. You wouldn't? What is that supposed to mean?
Tommy. So is something, going on between you and Tuppence?
No. Why would you say something like that? We're just business partners. Now, let's get back to the real business. Where do we find a medium-hyped woman who's stern-looking and has dark hair? Most likely in the company of an unsavory criminal.
Like, that one over there.
Well, so it is. Those are the two people I saw talking about Jane Finn. We must follow them.
I'll take the, Whittington, since there's no way that she'll recognize me.
Then I'll take the other one. They're taking their leave of one of another now. We'd best be on the chase.
I would say good luck, but we don't need it. Cousin Jane is close, and we are gonna find her.
password.
Mr. Brown.
Come in.
Is everything in order for today's meeting?
As far as I can tell, the German is upstairs in her office.
Ah, good. I have some things to discuss with her. I left a box out in the shed. Get it for me before the others arrive.
But my orders are to monitor
just
the...
Just get it.
Yes, sir.
Conrad, are you out there? Where is that box?
Here's the box you wanted, Boris.
Ah, that is number 5, remember? Mr. Brown doesn't want our guests to know our names.
Yeah. What's my number again?
You don't have a number, you idiot. Mr. Brown would never trust you enough to give you one.
I forgot.
You have one job and one job only, and that is to monitor the door. It looks like you better get to it.
Password?
Mr. Bro.
Come in.
Gin number, comrade.
14, Governor.
Correct.
Where is everyone?
The others will be here shortly. Take a seat.
Password?
Mr. Brown.
Come in.
Gin number, comrade.
7.
Correct. Password?
Mr. Brown.
Come in.
Number, comrade.
Number 12.
Correct. I think that just leaves our special guest. There he is now.
Password?
Mr. Brown.
Please come in, sir.
We are honored to be in your presence, number one. I fear it will be impossible.
It will not be possible again. I can do nothing without Mr. Brown. Is he here?
We have received a message. It is impossible for him to be here in person.
I understand. I have heard of his methods. He works in the dark and trusts no one. Still, it is possible that he is among us. So be it. Let us proceed.
So all is going as planned. All of our people are in place.
That's all very well, but money is essential. No money, no results.
And can you guarantee results?
In a month from now, sooner or later, as you wish, I will guarantee you such a reign of terror in Ireland as shall shake the foundations of the British Empire.
That is good. Then you shall have the money. Number 5, you'll see to that.
Would you like that via the Irish Americans and Mr. Potter, as usual?
I'd like to point out that there's no longer the sympathy there once was. There is a growing attitude to let the Irish settle their own affairs, without interference from America.
Does that matter, since the money only nominally comes from the States?
We are able to receive the money easily enough thanks to our colleague here.
That is good. Now, in the matter of the loan to the English newspaper, you have arranged the details satisfactorily, number 5?
I believe so.
That is good. An official denial from Moscow will be forthcoming if necessary.
I have been directed by Mr. Brown to place the various reports of the unions in front of you. That, to the minor, is most satisfactory. First, we must hold back on the railways.
And the date for our takeover?
The 29th.
That is rather soon.
I know, but it was settled by the union leaders, and we cannot appear to interfere too much.
Yes, yes. I understand. They must have no inkling that we are using them for our own ends. Then we are assured of success.
I think so. What if the union leaders do not declare a general strike on the 29th?
Why wouldn't they?
Because they are honest men. And despite all we have done to discredit the British government in their eyes, I'm not sure they are holding out faith in it.
I was given to understand that there is a certain document in existence that will assure success.
That is true. If that document were placed before the union leaders, the result would be immediate. They would publish it throughout England and declare revolution. The British government would fall, finally and completely.
Then why hasn't the document been brought to the union leaders?
We don't have it.
Do you know where it is?
We think it might be in the hands of a young American girl.
A girl. And you have not made her talk. In Russia, we have ways of making a girl talk. I'm sure number 14 could manage such a task.
Just look me at her.
This case is different.
Where is the girl now?
The girl?
Yes.
We believe she's in... I wonder how Tommy and Julius are getting along. I haven't heard one word from either of them since we split up the other day. It really was a lucky turn of events that Julius already knew Rita's full name, and it wasn't hard to track down her address. But still one problem remains. How to get her to tell me everything she knows about Jane Finn? Perhaps she'll believe that this child's toy police badge is the real thing. It's not likely. Keep up, Albert. We don't have all day.
I'm sorry, Annie, but this bag is awfully heavy.
So is mine, but you don't see me complaining.
Of course not. You never complain about anything.
What was that?
Nothing, nothing.
Then why don't you keep your mouth closed and hurry with those bags?
Sure thing. Oh!
Albert, how could you? We really don't have time for this.
It was an accident.
Well, Miss Vandermeer isn't going to care if it was an accident or not. She's going to have my head for this one.
You go on without me. I'll just pick these groceries up and be right behind you.
Fine, but you'd better be quick about it. Can I help you?
Oh, thank you, miss. I'd be much obliged.
So, who is that girl you're talking to? Your sister?
Oh, gosh, Annie ain't no sister of mine. She and I work in the house of Mrs. Vandermeer.
Mrs. Vandermeer? Look, kid, what did you say your name was?
I didn't say, but it's Albert, miss.
Albert. Can you keep a secret?
Oh, boy, sure can. What is it?
Do you know what this is?
No, miss.
American Detective Force.
Oh, my, just like in the movies. But what do you want with me?
You said you work for a Mrs. Vandermeer. Is that Rita Vandermeer?
Sure is. Is she the one you're after?
She is. She's known in the States as... Ready, Rita. We want to bring her in for some questioning.
Ready, Rita. Oh, ain't that just like in the movies? Is there anything I can do to help? Maybe shadow Mrs. Vandermeer and pass along any suspicious behavior to you?
We'll see, Albert. But one thing's for sure. Make sure you keep this business to yourself. We wouldn't want the wrong sort of people to learn about your involvement in American Detective Force investigation.
I'll not bring the word. Imagine that, working under the same house as a real-life criminal. Annie always said our mistress was up to no good. She said to me many times, mark my words, Albert, I wouldn't be surprised if the police were to come after her one of these days. That's why Annie's leaving. She can't take it no more.
Did you say Annie was leaving?
Sure is, just as soon as she can find to train her replacement.
You've got me thinking. Albert, do you think you could give me that job as the parlor maid? You could say I was your cousin or a friend.
Sure thing. Just leave it to me, miss, and I'll fix up the whole thing in two tips.
Thank you, Albert. How about I meet you at Mrs. Vandermeer's home tomorrow at 9 o'clock, and you can make the introductions.
Sure thing.
Good day, Albert.
But, miss, how will you know how to find the place?
American Detective Force, Albert.
Oh, yes, how exciting! Just like in the movie!
Looks like you came in handy after all. This new girl had better work out. I can't stand another day in this place. What is taking Albert so long?
I'm right here, miss. This here's my cousin, Prudence. She's the one I told you about, the one who's interested in the parlor maid job.
She's crazy to want it, but she's more than welcome to it. I'm Annie, and I'll be leaving this awful place once the missus gets the okay that you'll do to fill the position. You can help me serve tea today to Mrs. Vandermeer and her guest. She'll observe your performance and let you know if you missed it.
Thank you. I look forward to this opportunity.
You may not be thanking me later. Now come with me. We need to get tea service together.
I shall be along in a moment. Thank you, Albert. But more importantly, the American Detective Force thanks you. It was a great idea to use my Christian name. No one knows me as Prudence anymore.
I'm at your service, Miss Cowley. This case gets more exciting by the day. I sure hope Annie Tuffin succeeds in getting the missus to talk. Albert? I'm expecting a guest shortly. Please wait by the door and show him in when he arrives.
Sure thing.
Ma'am, I'd like to introduce you to Prudence Cooper. She's here as a candidate for my position.
I can't imagine why you'd want to leave, Annie. But I suppose we can give Prudence a chance. Now tell me, Miss Cooper, do you have any experience as a parlor maid?
I do, Mrs. Vandermeer. I last worked with Mrs. Stufferson at the parsonage at Lanley. You may write to her for a reference if you'd like.
That won't be necessary. If you perform well at today's tea, the position is yours. But let me say, you speak as if you are educated. Why do you want the job of a parlor maid?
Times are hard, Mrs. Vandermeer. There's hardly any work out there for a young, unmarried woman such as myself. I would be ever so glad for a position in a nice household such as this.
Very well. Annie will inform you of your duties.
Come along, then. There's much to get ready in the kitchen.
That'll be Boris now.
Boris Ivanovich to see you, madam.
Thank you, Albert.
Ah, it's delightful to see you, madam.
And you as well, Boris. Won't you sit down?
Is it safe to talk?
Of course it is. You know no one even dreams I have any connection with our mutual friend, Mr. Brown.
And the staff? You can trust them.
Really, Boris, you are absurdly suspicious. I'm trying out a new girl for the position of parlor maid, but she's just the cousin of one of my porter boys. Now tell me, what is the news from headquarters?
Everything is going as planned. The only hard part will be getting the union leaders to commit to a general strike on the 29th.
Yes, it's always more difficult when you're dealing with honest men. I much prefer to deal with criminals. So tell me, Mr. Ivanovich, have you seen any good plays lately?
Not lately, but I did hear that there's a new production in the West End.
Oh, yes. I believe it received a good review in the Times.
Yes.
And what of the girl? Has she let on as to the location of the treaty?
Not yet, but we're developing some new ways to get her to talk.
Let me know if I can be of assistance. I never refuse the opportunity to use a little torture, when necessary.
So tell me, Mrs. Vandermeer, what do you think of the new French restaurant on Regent Street?
Ah, oh, it is simply divine. The coq au vin is to die for.
By the way, I do not think it is a good idea for you to be going around town with Sir Peel Edgerton. Not only is he the most celebrated lawyer in all of town, but his special hobby is criminology. It is madness.
Who knows? In our line of work, it may come in handy sometime.
You are a clever woman, Rita, but you are also a fool. Give up, Bill Edgerton.
I think not. You forget, Boris, that I am accountable to no one. I take my orders only from Mr. Brown.
They say that Bill Edgerton can smell a criminal. Even now, what is at the bottom of his sudden interest in you? Perhaps his suspicions are aroused.
Reassure yourself, my dear Boris. Peel Edgerton suspects nothing. You're lacking your usual chivalry today. You seem to forget that I am commonly described as a beautiful woman. I assure you, that is all that interests Peel Edgerton.
He has studied crime like no other. Do you really think that you can deceive him?
It would amuse me to try. Besides, he is very rich, and I am awfully fond of money.
Money. Money, that is all you think about, Rita. I believe you would sell your soul for money. I believe you would sell us for money.
Perhaps, if the price was right. But it would take nothing less than a millionaire to do so.
You'll see, I was right.
My dear Boris, can you not take a joke? That will be Peel Edgerton now. I suppose you can see yourself out.
I will exit through the back. Until next time.
Sir James Peel Edgerton to see you, madam.
Thank you, Albert. That will be all. I'll be ready in a moment, darling. Let me go freshen up.
I eagerly await your return, my dear. Ah, so it appears Rita has a new parlor maid.
Yes, sir.
Rita doesn't seem to be able to keep parlor maids for very long. There are plenty of good jobs out there for them. Perhaps you would consider making a change.
Do you mean to say
that? Just a hint, that's all.
Ready, darling?
I'm always ready to escort you for an evening out.
I suppose the job is yours, Prudence. Clean up here, and you can tell Annie her services are no longer required. I will expect you to report tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock sharp. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Business Whittington would have in a hospital.
There really hasn't been any change, I'm afraid. That's really a shame. We entrust her into your care to get results.
I'm sorry, ma'am, but we have tried everything within our protocols.
That isn't good enough.
What would you like for me to do?
I'd like you to discharge her into my care immediately.
I'm afraid I can't do that, ma'am. It says here that she is a ward of Miss Rita Vandermeer.
Well, look again. I'm sure there's someone else who can take care of her in the event that Mrs. Vandermeer is unavailable.
Let's see. Oh, yes, here it is. Other than Rita Vandermeer, my orders are to release her to a Mr. Brown.
Well, today is my lucky day, for I am Mrs. Brown, Mr. Brown's wife.
Is that so? Well, come with me and we'll fill out the discharge paperwork.
Mr. Brown, eh? Appears I've stumbled upon quite the clue here.
It looks like everything is in order then.
You'll accompany us home?
Yes, I'll make sure she gets settled in. Come along, darling, it's time to go now.
Oh, can't you quiet her down? I don't want this whole hospital to know our business.
I'll give her a sedative before we reach the train. We're ready to go now.
Oh, could you grab her chart for me? We'll need it for the trip. All right, then let's hurry. Hospitals make me nervous.
Ah! Oh! Ow, my ankle! What is all the commotion? This is the woman's ward. You're not a woman. Doctor, my name is Handshaker. Lewis Handshaker.
All right, Mr. Handshaker, what business you have in my hospital?
Well, sir, you see, it's about a girl.
Ah, yes, it always is.
You see, I met her a few days ago in the town square, but I never got her name. So I've been, tracking her ever since. And I thought I saw her enter your hospital, perhaps to speak with one of your patients.
All right, but why didn't you come in the front door like a respectable young man?
I thought maybe it would be more, romantic if I were to scale the tree.
Quite a romance. I'm afraid, sir, it appears you have sprained your ankle. You have to remain with us for a few days while it heals.
I understand, sir.
Now, remain here and rest while we make up a room for you in the men's ward.
Oh, and wait, one more thing.
Yes? Do you happen to have a patient here by the name of Jane Finn?
No, I can't say that we do.
I see.
That's the name of your special girl, isn't it? Well, don't worry, Mr. Handshaker. I'm sure you'll find your Jane Finn someday.
I hope you're right, Doctor. I hope you are right.
I believe we'll just have tea for two, please. What a story! I can't believe you sprained your ankle.
Yeah, I only wish I had gotten a better look at that young girl's chart first. I know it would have given us a clue as to the whereabouts of Mr. Brown.
I don't know about you, but I am really starting to worry about Tommy. It's been 5 days since we split up, and neither you nor I have heard anything from him.
Oh, buck up, Tuppence. Oh. I'm sure he's all right. Besides, he was following a foreign-looking man. Perhaps they've gone abroad. Poland, maybe.
He couldn't have done that without passports and things. Besides, I just saw the man he was following the other day at Rita Vandermeer's.
Tommy is a grown man, Tuppence. I'm sure he's just fine.
I just hope you're right.
Are you crying, Tuppence? Is there possibly more to your relationship with Mr. Beresford than a simple business partnership?
Of course not. Don't be silly. Now, let's get back to the matter at hand. Whittington's a dead end, since we don't know where she's gone. I still have my position at Rita's, but nothing's happened over there for a few days.
So what do we do now?
I had an interesting exchange the other day with a friend of Rita's, Sir James Peel Edgerton. He's a famous lawyer here in London. He seemed to be trying to give me a hint of some kind. I thought he might be some help to us.
Wait, are you telling me that you think that a lawyer and a friend of Rita's could be of help to us?
Sure, why not?
Let me say it again, Tuppence. He is a lawyer!
I understand your concern, but I really think that he's on the side of the good. In fact, I asked him to meet us here to see if he'd be of any help.
All right, Tuppence, but don't say I didn't warn you.
Oh, here he is now.
Miss Prudence, I got your message that you wanted to see me. What is this all about?
Before we go any further, let me ask you one question. Did you mean to warn me against Mrs. Vandermeer the other day?
As far as I recall, I only mentioned that there were equally good jobs available elsewhere.
Yes, I know, but it was a hint, wasn't it?
I suppose it was. I felt I could not leave without giving you some advice. The household of Mrs. Vandermeer is no place for a young and inexperienced girl. That is all I can tell you. I would also like a cup of tea with these fine folks.
All right, although you should know that I'm not really inexperienced. I knew perfectly well who she was before I went there. In fact, that's why I went there.
I'm afraid I don't understand. Perhaps you should start from the beginning.
Well, if I'm starting at the beginning, then you should know that while my Christian name is Prudence, everyone calls me Tuppence.
Very well, Tuppence. You may call me Sir James. And is this your friend, Mr. Beresford, who you wrote about?
No, actually, this is Mr. Hersheimer from America. He's here looking for the same girl we are, his cousin, Jane Finn.
Ah, yes, Jane Finn. I am quite aware of that situation. My position in court allows me certain information in politics.
Yeah, just how much do you know?
I am aware of the treaty Jane Finn likely had in her possession when she left the Lusitania. I am also aware that Jane Finn has been missing for quite some time.
4 very, very long years.
Indeed. And I'm aware of a certain organization run by the mysterious Mr. Brown has their own interest in finding the young lady. They will stop at nothing until they do. What I don't understand is how you, Tuppence, and your friend Tommy got mixed up in all this.
Tommy and I have formed a joint venture known as the Young Adventurers Limited. We were hired by a high-level British intelligence agent known to us as Mr. Carter, to find Jane Finn.
I see. Well, if this is not Mr. Beresford, then where is he?
That's what I'm worried about. No one has heard anything from him, not since he started tracking that Russian fellow, Boris.
See. Well, it is my opinion that we should not waste time in finding your friend Tommy. I know Rita well, and by association, Boris Ivanovich. They are not people to be trusted. Your friend could be in grave danger.
Does this mean that you'll help us?
Absolutely. In fact, there's one person quite near at hand who in all probability knows where he is, and that's Rita Vandermeer.
Yes, but Rita would not ever tell us.
That's where I come in. I think it's quite likely that I should be able to make Mrs. Vandermeer tell me what I want to know. Now tell me, Tuppence, is Mrs. Vandermeer dining out tonight?
Yes, I believe so, but she should not be out late.
Good. I will call upon her at 10 o'clock. That's when I'll corner her and get her to talk.
Miss Tuppence, the crook Miss Vandermeer is packing up and leaving town right now.
What?
It's the truth. I figured you didn't know anything about it, so I rushed right out to find you.
You're a gem, Albert. If it hadn't been for you, we would have lost her.
Quickly now, there's no time to lose. We must get to her before she leaves. If not, Tuppence, you may never see your friend Tommy again.
Doing here? It's your day off. You aren't due back until 9:30 this evening.
I had a toothache, ma'am.
Oh, how unfortunate for you. You had better go to bed.
I shall be all right in the kitchen, ma'am.
Cook is out. I sent her out, so you had better go to bed.
But another word
out of you. You really think I didn't know? No, don't answer. If you struggle or cry out, I'll kill you without a second thought. Now march!
Not another
word out of you! When I'm done with you, you'll go to bed as I told you. And you'll sleep, my little spy. Oh, yes, you'll sleep all right.
Come now, this is nonsense. You can't kill me. Someone would find out and call the police.
I'd risk that. But as long as you don't struggle or cry out, you'll be fine. And I don't think you will. You're a clever girl.
What's that?
A little something to make you sleep soundly.
Are you going to poison me?
Perhaps.
Then I won't drink it. I'd much rather be shot. I won't be killed off quietly like a lamb.
You little fool. It's a sleeping tonic, that is all. You'll wake up tomorrow morning, none the worse. I simply do not want the bother of tying you up and gagging you. I can be very rough when I choose. Now drink it down, like a good girl, and you'll be fine.
I don't believe it! It's poison! I know it's poison! Don't make me drink it! Don't make me drink it!
Get up, you little idiot! How you managed to deceive me in the first place, I will never know. You're nothing but a coward. Now you know who's on top of the situation and who's underneath. Now drink it at once!
You swear it won't hurt me?
Of course it won't hurt you. Don't be a fool.
Very well.
No!
Now who's on top of this situation and who's underneath?
You did that well, girl, but you shall pay for it. Oh, yes. You shall pay. I have a long memory.
Did you really think I was the kind of girl to go rolling on the floor and beg for mercy?
You may find yourself doing just that someday.
Well, not today. Now it's your turn to sit down. We have some matters to discuss.
Oh, really? And what could I have to say that would interest the likes of you?
Money.
Money, you say?
A long memory isn't as useful as a large purse. I dare say you'd enjoy coming up with all sorts of dreadful things to happen to me, but is that practical? Revenge is very unsatisfactory. But money, there's nothing unsatisfactory about that, now is there?
Do you really think I am the type of woman to sell out my friends?
Yes. If the price was right.
You don't have that kind of money.
You're right. I don't, but my client does. In fact, he has millions.
Millions, you say? And what does he want to know, this friend of yours?
He wants to know where Jane Finn is.
Is that all?
If anyone knows, it's you, Rita Vandermeer.
Actually, I don't. But I could find out. Is that all?
No. There's a young man, a friend of mine. I think something happened to him, possibly at the hands of your pal, Boris. His name is Tommy Beresford.
I've never heard of him. But I could ask Boris. He'll tell me anything he knows.
Thank you. But there's one more thing.
Well?
Who is Mr. Brown?
You can't know very much about us if you don't realize that none of us know who Mr. Brown is.
You do.
What makes you say that?
I don't know, but I'd bet almost anything that you know who he is.
It's dangerous to know too much, and sometimes lately, I've been afraid.
Once Mr. Brown is caught, you'll be out of danger.
Will I? Will I ever be? Even the walls have ears. You don't know him. I tell you, he's...
What?
It's her heart. Get some water and quickly tap it, or she'll slip through our fingers.
It's my heart. I mustn't talk.
It's all right. There'll be plenty of time for talking later. You just rest for now.
That was a really close call.
In more ways than one. She had a gun, but she wanted me to drink a sleeping tonic.
You could have been killed, Tuppence. You really should be more careful.
It wasn't like there was a lot of time to think about it. Besides, I got the best of her in the end. She was just about to tell me the identity of the notorious Mr. Brown when the two of you arrived.
Well, if she was willing to tell you moments ago, hopefully she'll be just as willing to tell us in the morning when she's feeling better.
So what do we do until then?
We should stay here. We wouldn't want her to start feeling better and get away from us.
She might try that. She seemed very afraid of Mr. Brown.
Is that so?
Yes. She kept looking around and said something about the walls having ears.
Ah! Perhaps she thinks Mr. Brown may have hidden a dictaphone recording in the walls and was recording everything that we said.
It is possible. Tuppence is right. We mustn't leave the flat, if only for Mrs. Vandermeer's sake.
But do you really think Mr. Brown could get to her between now and tomorrow morning? I mean, how could he even know that she's working with us?
We have a formidable adversary on our hands.
Then let us take up a vigil by her bedside.
Good idea, Tuppence. Why don't you head down to the kitchen for some food and drink? Julius and I will take the first watch.
I'll be back in a moment.
No, don't leave me.
It's okay. I'm just going down to the kitchens to get some refreshments. I'll be right back.
But Mr. Brown...
That was odd.
There's one thing that I don't fully understand. What caused Mrs. Vandermeer to try and clear out so quickly?
I don't know. Let's take a look around the room. Perhaps we'll unearth a clue. Why, these suitcases are in great disorder. It appears as though her flight from the premises was not premeditated. Perhaps she was warned by someone suddenly.
Ah! And here's the gun she was holding when Tuppence came in. I'll just, hold on to that.
Can I trust you with the gun?
As much as I can trust you.
Very well. You may hold on to it for the time being. I'm going to see how our patient is doing. Her pulse is slow but steady. She should be all right in the morning.
She really is a beautiful woman. I only wish she could have told us the secret identity of Mr. Brown, so we could be closer to finding my cousin.
I have some refreshments. Now we're able to settle in for a long night. Perhaps Mrs. Vandermeer would like something to drink. Mrs. Vandermeer, try to open your eyes and take a sip. Mrs. Vandermeer,
Mrs. Vandermeer! I don't know how, but Mr. Brown's done it again.
Done what? What do you mean?
What is it?
It's Mrs. Vandermeer. She's dead.
All right, everybody, I hope you enjoyed the play so far. It is now intermission time, so as I mentioned earlier, please let the thespians use the restroom first. After that, you guys will have a 10-minute restroom break for you guys to use, and we'll come back and continue the play after that.
Hello, number 14.
Hello, Governor. I was told you wanted to meet me here, away from the rest of the gang.
Yes. I was told that if I wanted to get something done, then you're the guy to do it.
That's right, Governor. I ain't afraid of nobody or nothing.
Then I suppose you have good news for me.
I guess you're talking about the treaty everyone's so anxious about.
Yes. Have you found a way to make the girl talk?
Well, now, you see, that's
the thing. Have the treaty or not?
Now, Governor, there's no need to get... Wait, aren't you?
Oh no!
I can't believe Mr. Brown managed to get into the house and poison Rita. How he managed to get in unnoticed is beyond me.
Unless he was already in the house.
Are you accusing me of something, Mr. Hersheimer? Because if I remember correctly, there were two of us in that room.
I'm not-
Stop it, you two! Arguing isn't going to get us any closer to finding Jane or Tommy.
Or Mr. Brown, for that matter.
Quite right. Rita is no longer a source of information for us. So what do we do now?
I found that where this case is concerned, when one door closes on us, fate seems to make another way.
That it does.
Ah! I believe fate has just stepped in once again. Dr. Hall! Dr. Hall, won't you join us?
Ah, my young friend who, fell out of a tree. How was your ankle feeling?
I suppose that your very skillful treatment has cured it, Doctor.
And the heart trouble?
Still searching. Now, if you have a couple minutes, I think that we have a few questions for you.
I suppose I can spare a few minutes for a former patient and his friends. What can I do for you nice folks?
Dr. Hall, my name is Sir James Peel Edgerton.
I know who you are, Sir Edgerton. All of London knows who you are.
You are too kind, Dr. Hall. Now, I'm anxious to find a certain young lady, and we believe that she was maybe a patient in your hospital.
Is this a matter of testimony?
Yes. Now, the girl's name is immaterial, as she was likely submitted to you under an assumed name. Do you happen to be acquainted with a Mrs. Vandermeer?
Is that Rita Vandermeer?
Yes. Now, you may not be aware of recent events, but Mrs. Vandermeer is dead. It appears she took an overdose of a sleeping tonic last night.
Such a shame. She was a beautiful woman. But what does this have to do with the girl you were searching for?
We believe Mrs. Vandermeer may have submitted a young relative of hers into your hospital.
Indeed. A young one was introduced to us as Miss Vandermeer's niece. We knew her as Janet Vandermeer. She came to the hospital in June. Or was it July? Of 1915.
And, Doctor, at that time, was she being treated for mental issues?
She is perfectly sane, if that is what you mean. I understood from Miss Vandermeer that the girl was with her on the Lusitania when the ill-fated ship was sunk. She suffered a severe shock.
I believe that we're on the right track.
You spoke of wanting a statement from her, but unless you want one prior to May 7, 1915, I'm afraid she won't be able to give one to you.
But why?
Because Janet Vandermeer suffers from a complete loss of memory.
What?
She remembers nothing.
Nothing prior to May 7, 1915. After that, her memory's as good as yours or mine.
And the first thing that she remembers?
Is landing with the survivors. Everything before that is blank. She couldn't remember where she was from, her own name. She couldn't even speak her own native language. She only spoke French. Doctor, surely this is most unusual. It's quite normal under the circumstances, really. She suffered a severe shock to the nervous system.
And the treatment for such a diagnosis?
There is none. All we can do is wait.
Can anything be done to help things along?
Sometimes, another shock will do the trick. One restores what the other took away.
And then I will spare no expense! Or perhaps we could recreate the sinking of the Lusitania. Experiencing that same shock again might just cause her to regain her memory?
Perhaps, but I couldn't possibly give you a guarantee of success.
Oh, Doctor, that's all right. You just fetch Janet for us and leave the rest to us.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Handshaker, but I thought you were aware that Janet Vandermeer is no longer under my care.
What? What? Wait, what do you mean?
She was actually discharged when you had your little, accident.
To think I was right under the exact same roof as her!
Wait, I don't understand. I thought you didn't know Janet Vandermeer.
Well, I'm much obliged to you, Dr. Hall. I believe you've answered all of our questions sufficiently.
Anytime. Feel free to contact me if you have any more questions.
We will. Thank you, Dr. Hall.
No, I'm afraid I must take my leave as well. I am needed at Scotland Yard right away.
But I thought you were going to help us find Tommy. And now we know that Janet Vandermeer has got to be Jane Finn.
I'm afraid at this point all of our current leads have dried up. There's nothing more to do than hope for the best. But feel free to contact me should any new information come to light. Good day.
I always figured he was a quitter.
Now what are we going to do, Julius? What if we never see Jane or Tommy again?
Well, you know, Tuppence, you could always marry me.
Now is not a time for jokes, Julius.
Who's joking? I think you're a nice enough girl, and I have piles of money to lavish upon you. So what do you say? Would you like to be the wife of, Julius P. Hersheimer?
Miss Tuppence! Miss Tuppence! A telegram came for you over at Mrs. Vandermeer's place.
I don't believe it!
What? What is it?
It's from Tommy!
What happened? Oh, that's right. Guess my hiding spot wasn't as good as I thought.
He's coming too. Are you feeling better?
I suppose so.
You are lucky you have such a sick skull. The good Conrad struck hard.
I good, huh, boss?
So you're Conrad, are you? Well, seems like you also know a thing or two about being thick-headed.
What does that mean?
Oh, don't worry your thick little head about what it means. Just know, I'll pay you back for that someday.
Enough! Do you have any last words before you are put to death as a spy?
Yes, I do.
How did you get in?
Oh, well, you have your good buddy Conrad to thank for that. He stepped away from his post just long enough for me to walk through the front door.
It was not my fault. Horace said he needed some stuff from the shed.
Conrad is right. Besides, his hasty action has given me the pleasure of seeing your lovely faces.
Zedman tell no tales.
Ah, but I'm not dead yet.
But you soon will be, my young friend.
I think not, as I have a great objection to dying. Besides, you've had plenty of opportunity to kill me already. I've been unconscious for quite some time.
Yes, but...
But you didn't know how much I knew, or where I obtained that information. And if you kill me now, you'll never know.
Yeah, we should just kill him now, boss.
If anyone is going to kill this swine of an Englishman, it is me!
Ha! You will neither kill me nor torture me.
And why not?
Because I have information that only someone on the inside could have given me. Ask yourself this. How did I know where to find your secret hideout? Seems to me like someone's been spilling the beans, and only I know who that is.
That is true. Comrades, we have been betrayed.
Your life is not worth figuring out which one of us is a snitch. Boris, prepare to put an end to young Mr. Bear.
I would rethink that. I may know where to find the treaty that you want so badly.
The treaty? Do you have it?
No, but I think I can get my hands on it.
And how do you expect to do that while you are a prisoner here?
Well, obviously, you're going to have to let me go on my way. I promise I'll come back as soon as I find the treaty.
Just let you walk out of here. You must think I am stupid.
You said it, not me.
You remain a prisoner here. One of our men will carry out your instructions down to the detail. Those are our terms. Do you have any other choices? Death.
Well, when you put it that way,
we will leave him here while we formulate a plan to end the treaty.
You know, can I get something to eat and drink? I haven't eaten since you hit me over the head. And just so you know, comrade, you will pay for that.
Our housemaid Annette will attend to your needs.
Boris, comrade, let us save young Mr. Beresford to gather his stones.
If I had my way, you would be dead already.
Oh, poor Boris. Is he a crybaby when he doesn't get his way?
I wouldn't know. I always get my way. Sooner or later.
I'm so sorry. I thought you were someone else.
Who did you think I was, monsieur?
I thought... Wait. Could you possibly be the girl I've been searching for? Are you Jane Finn?
My name's Annette, monsieur.
I see. Wait.
Yes, monsieur?
Have you ever heard that name?
Jane Finn? I think I may have heard some man here say that name.
But you don't know where she is. Is she here, in this house?
I must go now. They'll be waiting for me.
Look here, Annette. I need you to help me get out of here.
Impossible. They told me I was here right down the hallway. Besides, they are my own people, I think. You have spied upon them, and they asked the right to keep you here.
They're a bad lot, Annette. If you get me out of here, I'll take you away.
I dare not, monsieur. I'm afraid of them.
Then will you do it for another girl? She's about your age, too. Will you save her from their evil clutches?
Do you mean Jane Finn? Is it she you came looking for?
Yes. She's very important to a lot of people.
I'm sorry, I just can't.
Huh. Annette seems really upset about this picture being on the floor. She must really take her job as a housemaid seriously. Then again...
There's our favorite prisoner.
The boss doesn't trust you not to make a run for it. So we're here to make sure you stay put.
You thought you'd bluffed us, did you? You know less than a kitten.
Well, then I still know more than you, Conrad.
The boss saw right through your little speech. And now, your number's up.
But why tie me up? Why not just kill me and be done with me?
You really think that we're stupid enough to kill you with all these police snooping around?
Well, if you're asking me whether or not I think you're stupid, Conrad, you should already know the answer.
There is a carriage coming for you tomorrow morning to take you to your doom. Until then, we're not taking any chances.
You're making a sad mistake. But the loss will be yours.
I sincerely doubt it. Have a good night, you swine.
Sleep tight.
I've really done it this time. Tuppence, if you could only hear me, I'd tell you how much I love you and want us to be together forever. But it's no use. Unless a miracle happens, I'll never see Tuppence's sweet face again.
I could not leave you here tied up like a dog.
Annette, you're a lifesaver. Please say you'll come with me. I know many people who would help you.
I can't. Not now anyway, but I will help you in whatever way I can.
How many are there out there now?
Just Boris and Conrad. The Germans upstairs in their office, and the others have gone out.
Do you think you could give me a few minutes and then find a way to get them in here?
I'll do my best. Good luck. Boris, Conrad, come quickly. The prisoner doesn't look well.
What?
And that is payback! Hey, go back here, you swine!
I really don't understand why you insist on meeting out here in such a public place. Surely your offices are no longer under construction and we can meet there.
They're not under construction anymore, that's for sure.
Then why don't we go there instead?
They're, being fumigated.
Fumigated?
Yes. Termites. Eating up all the new construction.
Fine, we'll meet here. What news do you have for me?
Well, I just came from inside Mr. Brown's hideout.
How did you manage to infiltrate his hideout? We've been trying to get in for months.
Well, I just walked through the front door.
You what? Never mind. What information do you have for me?
You were right. I witnessed a meeting between high-powered political leaders and government officials from every corner of Great Britain, including Bolshevik leaders and union officials. They were discussing a plan to start a general strike on the 29th of this month. Their hope? To weaken the British government so that the Bolsheviks can come in and seize control.
So that's just as we thought, though we had no idea about the general strike on the 29th. How did you manage to witness this meeting?
Well, I was hiding behind some barrels in their meeting room, until I was discovered, of course, and held captive. I only just escaped and found you right away.
And was Jane Finn there? Did you see her?
You know, I'm not sure. There was a housemaid there by the name of Annette. There was something odd about her, though. Can't put my finger on it, but I bet anything she isn't any ordinary housemaid.
Speaking of housemaids, your friend Tuppence has been bombarding me with letters about you. Seems she hasn't heard from you in a while and feared you dead.
Tuppence? Well, I was afraid she'd be getting a bit rattled. I'll go find her now.
And I'll report your findings to the Prime Minister. He's been following this case closely and will want to hear about these new developments. Good day.
So, Tuppence was worried about me after all. I can't wait to find her to show her that I'm all right. I'm sure she'll be so happy that she'll just... Julius!
Holy snakes, Tommy! Is it really you? Tuppence and I were beginning to worry.
That's what I heard. Where is the old girl now?
She must be out shopping. But enough about Tuppence. Where have you been?
There'll be time for details later. But suffice it to say, I just came from inside the headquarters of Mr. Brown and his associates, and barely escaped with my life.
That must have been quite the adventure.
Unless I saw you, you were hot on the trail of Whittington. What came of that?
You see, that is a very long story, one we can discuss in greater detail at a later time. But I can say that with the help of Tuppence and her lawyer friend, Sir James Peel Edgerton, we've discovered that Mr. Brown does in fact have Jane captive. And she has completely lost her memory.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to get off topic, but did you say that Tuppence has a lawyer friend? What is he like? Is he handsome? Did Tuppence seem interested in him romantically?
Tommy, when this whole thing is over, you two should just go on a date already.
What? I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, right you don't.
So, Jane Finn has lost her memory, eh? Well, this changes things, doesn't it? I wonder...
What is it? Did you possibly see her when you were in the hideout of Mr. Brown?
I'm not sure. It's just a theory. Oh, I wish Tuppence was here. I was expecting to have sort of a grand reunion with her.
Hersheimer?
Yes, I am. Who wants to know?
My name's Albert, sir, and I'm a friend of Tuppence. I have two telegrams for you. One's from Sir James, and the other's from Tuppence. She thought he might find you here at the cafe. Seems like to eat a great deal.
That's too right. Let me have a look at these. Found. Jane Finn, come to Royal London Hospital immediately. Holy snakes, they found her. Let's go, Tommy.
Wait. What about the telegram from Tuppence?
I forgot about that one. It's for me. It's about something I asked you about earlier.
Oh, really? And what was that?
Well, if you must know, I asked Tuppence to marry me earlier today.
We didn't waste any time with that, did you?
You should know, I didn't ask till it seems there was no chance of finding either you or Jane. I don't want to come between you and Tuppence if you have something going.
No. It's all right. Tuppence and I have been pals for years, and nothing more. Besides, she has made it perfectly clear what she wants out of a husband, and you seem better fit to give her what she wants.
Yeah, I suppose we'd get along all right. And besides, I've heard a girl must always refuse your proposal of marriage the first time, so I've got that out of the way.
Refuse? Did she refuse your proposal?
That's what this telegram says. Can't be bothered to think about marriage until Tommy is found. Let's leave it for now.
Well, there you have it. But now I'm here, and it's Tuppence who needs to be found.
She took a taxi, but I didn't hear where she was going. She just kept saying that she just had to get to her Tommy over and over again.
Did she say that?
And as she drove off in the taxi, she threw this out of the taxi window.
Let me see that. It's a telegram. Come at once. Found Mr. Brown's hideout. 153 Ebury Street in Soho. Signed, Tommy.
Tommy, did you send this?
Of course not. What does this mean?
I'm afraid. It means the worst, my friend. They've got her, Tommy. Mr. Brown has Tuppence, and you can be sure that he's not going to let her go alive.
I know you're anxious to see Jane, but I can't just stand around and do nothing while Tuppence is being held captive by Mr. Brown.
Well, maybe now you know how I've been feeling for months. I haven't always been Sir James' biggest supporter, but if he had managed to rescue Jane from the clutches of Mr. Brown, perhaps he could help us rescue Tuppence as well.
I hope you're right. But where is he? The nurse has brought us back here to wait, and neither Sir James nor Jane are anywhere to be seen.
I'm sure he'll be along any minute.
I'm sorry to keep you two gentlemen waiting. And you must be Mr. Beresford. I've heard so much about you from Tuppence that it seems as though I already know you quite well.
Well, thank you. Unfortunately, it seems that Tuppence has found her way into some trouble with Mr. Brown and his associates.
Yes. Well, perhaps, like yourself, she'll find her way out of a tight situation. I must commend you, Mr. Beresford. From what I hear, you display quite a bit of ingenuity in extricating yourself from the grasp of Mr. Brown.
Yes, well, fortunately I had some help.
Yes, the girl.
You seem to know an awful lot about my escape. Julius here been filling you in?
I have my connections, Mr. Beresford. Being a successful lawyer in London means you must know everything that goes on in this city.
Speaking of girls, when can we see Jane?
She was just having some tests administered. She should be right in.
What I want to know is, how did you manage to get back on her trail? We thought you were no longer on that case.
Oh, you thought that, did you? Well, she's been found, and that's the great thing, isn't it?
Yes, that is great. But how did you get back on her trail?
Let's just say that it's fortunate for both parties that we managed to find the young lady.
You mentioned Jane's been undergoing tests. Is something wrong with her?
The young lady was apparently knocked down in a street accident and sustained a slight injury to the head. She was brought here, and when she regained consciousness, she gave her name as Jane Finn. When I heard, I sent a telegram to you right away.
But she's not seriously hurt, is she?
Oh, a bruise, a cut or two. But from a medical point of view, she's fine. Her state is likely due to the sudden shock of recovering her memory.
Oh, it's come back!
Undoubtedly, Mr. Hersheimer, as she was able to give her real name.
And you just happened to be nearby when this happened? Seems like quite a fairy tale.
Coincidences are curious things.
I wish they'd hurry up and bring Jane out. That way we can start tracking Tuppence.
I doubt Tuppence is in any immediate danger. That is, as long as they don't know that we've got Jane Finn and that her memory has returned. We must keep that quiet at all costs, understand?
Of course.
Ah, and here's the patient now.
Look, Jane, you have visitors.
Hello.
Miss Finn, this is your cousin, Mr. Julius P. Hirschheimer.
He's the one I've been telling you about, the one who's been looking for you.
How do you do, Cousin Jane?
Are you really Uncle Hiram's son?
Yes, I am.
We used to read about Uncle Hiram in the papers, how he got rich. But I never thought I'd meet you one day. Mother figured Uncle Hiram would never get over his anger toward her.
The old man, he was like that. But I can assure you that as soon as the money was mine, I set about looking for you. We have a lot of lost years to make up for.
They've been telling me that I lost my memory, and that there are years I will never remember. Years of my life lost.
And you just didn't realize that yourself?
Why, no. It seems to me as though no time has passed since we were being hustled onto those lifeboats. I can see it now.
Now that brings us to a very important point, Jane. There was a man aboard that boat with some very important papers. Many people in this country believe he passed them to you. Is that so?
I don't know if I should say anything.
Oh, don't worry, cousin. These are the good guys. You can tell them anything.
In that case, yes. He said they would have a better chance with me, since they were saving the women and children first.
Then you can hand them over to us right away?
But I can't. I haven't got them.
You haven't got them?
No. I hid them. I got uneasy. People seemed to be watching me. It scared me. It's almost the last thing I remember before waking up in the hospital.
Well, go on. What do you remember?
I remember walking around a town square in London. There were shops and a cafe. I knew I needed to get some help, but I didn't know anyone. I saw a friendly-looking shop for glassware, or some such thing.
That must be Estonia Glassware. That's Whittington's place.
Outside was a potted plant. I looked around to make sure no one was watching, and I buried the oilskin packet deep down inside the pot.
Right, so the treaty has been right under our noses this entire time.
I was quite hungry by that point, so I went to the cafe to have a bite to eat. Then I went for a little walk, and I accidentally wandered down into a deserted alley. The next thing I know, something hit me in the back of my head right about here. I don't remember anything more before waking up in this hospital.
Well, thank you, Miss Finn. I hope we've not tired you out.
Oh, it's all right. My head aches a little, but otherwise I feel fine.
Then I suppose we best be going. The sooner we can find those papers, the sooner we can find Tuppence and Jane and put this whole mess behind us.
Cousin Jane, I'm going to go with Tommy and Sir James to sort out this matter of the tree. But I promise that as soon as I get back, we'll make up for all of the years we've lost.
Now, let us go, fellows. We have a long-lost treaty to find.
Can you believe it, Tommy? After all this time, it's going to be you and I that discover the location of such an important treaty.
Don't you think it's odd that Sir James didn't want to come along?
He said he had a speaking engagement, or some such thing that he couldn't get out of. And that suits me just fine, you know? I've never really cared for him myself.
Neither do I. But I still find it hard to believe. It's not like it would hurt his political aspirations if he were to be involved in the recovery of the treaty that essentially saved the British government from being overthrown.
Let us not waste any time talking about Sir James.
Well, there's Estonia Glassware. And there's the potted plant.
For all these years, this has just been sitting here for anyone to go digging through.
I've got it! Now that's odd. You'd think after 5 years, the stitches would be rotted. But they're not.
Well, open it up!
What?
It's blank.
This doesn't make any sense. There has to be another explanation. I've got it. I bet they wrote it in invisible ink.
You really think so?
Well, it's worth a try. He usually makes the ink appear. Do you happen to have any matches?
Of course I do. Julius P. Hirschheimer always comes prepared.
Well, here goes nothing. Oh, take a look at that.
Ah, you've got it. Now, what does it say?
With the compliments of Mr. Brown.
How in tarnation did he get ahead of us? Perhaps there was a dictaphone recording in Jane's room. Or maybe one of the nurses was listening at the door, and she alerted him.
I don't see what any of this matters. I already sent word to Carter that we were retrieving the tree and to meet us here. Now there's nothing to do but to wait for him to arrive.
Have you got it? Have you found the treaty?
This is all we found.
That's it, then.
What do you mean?
The treaty's in the hands of Mr. Brown. All we can do now is minimize the effect its publication will cause.
Mr. Brown has Tuppence and the treaty. It's hopeless.
Don't take it to heart, lad. You did your best. You were up against one of the greatest criminal masterminds of the century, and you came very near success. Remember that.
Thank you. That's awfully decent for you to say.
I blame myself. I've been blaming myself ever since I heard this other bit of news.
Is there something else?
I'm afraid so. Read for yourself.
Washed up on the coast near Yorkshire, a bit of a lady's red dress, most likely belonging to Tuppence Cowley. Seems much like foul play.
I'm sorry, Tommy.
Tuppence! Those devils! I'll never rest until I get even with them. I'll hunt them down,
Tommy, I know how you feel, my poor boy, but it's no use. My advice is to cut your losses. Time is merciful. You'll forget her one day.
Forget Tuppence? Never!
I'm sure you will, Tommy. I mean, time heals all wounds, correct?
I hate to think of that brave girl in their clutches. I'm sorry about this whole business.
No need to keep blaming yourself. You warned us. I just wish they had did away with me instead of my sweet...
Let me know if you need anything else, Tommy. Good day.
No, Tommy, I really am sorry. Poor little Tuppence, she was the pluckiest girl I've ever met.
Oh, get out of here! You don't really care anyway! You asked her to marry you in your rotten, cold-blooded way. But I loved her. I'd have given the soul out of my body to save her from harm. I would have stood by without a word and let you marry her because I knew you could have given her the life that she ought to have. That was a poor devil without a penny to my name.
Please, Tommy!
Get out! Go look after your cousin. Tuppence is my girl. She always has been. I've loved her since the time we played together as kids, to the time that I saw her dressed as a nurse in that army hospital. Then I fell in love with her all over again. We met at the cafe and formed the Young Adventurers Limited.
You know, now that you mention it, I would have sworn that Jane I saw today looked a lot like the person I saw Whittington talking to in the hospital a few weeks ago.
I don't care a lick about your cousin anymore. I only care about Tuppence. And now she's gone. And you need to go too. I suggest you go by your own free will, or I'll make you go.
Tommy, I'm sorry. I thought maybe you'd given me a clue.
You know something, Julius? I've never liked you. And I never trusted you. Someday you're gonna get what's coming to you. That much I promise. Now get out!
All right. I'm going. I'll be checking out Mr. Brown's hideout for myself if you want to know.
Mr. Hirschheimer, you dropped this! Oh, hello there, Mr. Beresford. Any luck in finding Miss Tuppence?
I'm afraid not, Albert. And it seems like no one ever will. It appears a bit of her red dress was washed up on the coast near Yorkshire.
Did you say it was a bit of a red dress?
Yes. Why?
I saw Miss Tuppence earlier that day. She wasn't wearing a red dress. Actually, she was wearing a blue one.
Albert, you just made me the happiest man in the world. But wait. Mr. Brown's men must have planted that bit of red dress to throw us off the trail. I should have known that Tuppence would be all right. It's like Julius always says. She's the pluckiest girl I know.
Speaking of your friend Mr. Hirschheimer, he dropped this photograph.
He's not my friend, and I don't care what he... What?
What is it?
Why would Julius have a photograph of Annette in his pocket?
Who is Annette?
The housemaid at the hideout of Mr. Brown.
You don't think Mr. Hersheimer could be in cahoots with Mr. Brown and his gang, do you?
No, I don't. I think he is Mr. Brown, and I know just where to find him.
Over here.
Just a few more days, boys, and our plan will be in full swing.
Full thing. A full-blown revolution in Great Britain. There is no end to the power of the Bolshevik organization.
Number one, there is a man here asking to see you.
Who is it?
He says his name is Julius P. Hersheimer.
Hersheimer. I have heard that name before.
He said that his father was one of the steel kings in America.
He must be a millionaire, several times over.
Send him in, comrade. A millionaire, several times over? This gentleman could be very useful to our cause.
Indeed. And American money is good. Very good.
Julius P. Hersheimer.
Mr. Kremenin.
Yes?
I have a few things I'd like to discuss with you, sir. If I might speak with you alone.
You may speak in front of Boris. I have no secrets from him.
That may be so, but I have. So I'd be obliged if you'd tell him to scoot.
Boris, perhaps you wouldn't mind retiring to the next room.
The next room won't do. I'm sure that there's a peephole in there somewhere, and I cannot risk my secrets getting out.
Will your business take long for you to stay?
It might, if it interests you as much as I think it will.
Very well. Boris, you and Conrad may take the rest of the night off.
Are you sure, boss? I don't know about this.
I like the looks of him, and I like his deep pockets even more. I can take care of myself. Your services are no longer required this evening.
Just so.
Now, Mr. Hersheimer, perhaps you'd be so kind as to come to the point.
I suppose I can do that. Hands up or I'll shoot!
This is an outrage! An outrage! Surely you don't mean to kill me?
Not if you keep your voice down. And don't even think about calling for help or you'll be dead.
What do you want? Do nothing rashly. My life is of the utmost value to my country. You would not get away easily if you killed me.
I'm pretty sure that any man who would put an end to you and your evil schemes would be doing humanity a great deal of good. Don't worry. I don't plan to kill you. Not yet.
What do you want? Money?
No. I want Jane Finn.
I've never heard of her.
You're a liar! You know exactly who I mean!
I tell you, I've never heard of the girl.
You will bring her to me, and then I shall take her to safety.
What you ask? It is an impossibility.
So, you're scared, eh? Of who? Mr. Brown?
Mr. Brown?
The mere mention of him has got you scared stiff, hasn't it, Kremenin?
I have seen him, spoken to him face to face, though I did not know until afterwards. He was one of a crowd. Who is he, really? I don't know. But I know this, he is a man to fear.
So, you can't give me what I'm asking for.
What you ask, it is an impossibility.
That's a pity for you. But the world in general will benefit.
Stop! You cannot mean to kill me.
Of course I do. I've always heard you revolutionists don't value human life very highly in the name of the cause. But everything changes when it's your own life that's put in question. I gave you one chance to save your dirty skin and you didn't take it.
They would kill me.
Maybe. Maybe not. You can be certain of one thing. If you don't tell me where Jane Finn is right now, I will kill you. And you can count on that. Speaking of counting, I'll give you to a count of five to tell me exactly where she is. I suppose if I get past four, you needn't worry about Mr. Brown. Perhaps we'll even send some flowers to your funeral. Now, if you're ready, I'll begin. One. Two. Three. Four.
All right, I'll do as you wish.
I thought you'd come to your senses. Now, where's Jane?
She's downstairs in the cellar. Whittington is keeping watch over her. Though I don't know why, the little fool has lost her memory. Curse her!
And what about the other girl?
The one you tricked with the phony telegram a few days ago.
She's here too, locked up with Miss Finn.
I want you to have the girls brought up here right now.
But
now!
Whittington, have the prisoners brought up here immediately. I hope you're happy. As soon as Mr. Brown finds out about this, we are all going to be dead. You hear me? All of us. You, me, Whittington, Jane Finn, and your precious girlfriend. You do not know the wrath of Mr. Brown, but you will soon find out. We all will.
Here they are, number one, just like you.
Don't make any sudden moves, Whittington, or number one here gets what's coming to him.
Julius, it's you! But how did you get into Mr. Brown's hideout so easily?
I'll tell you how. It's because Julius P. Hersheimer is Mr. Brown.
Tommy!
No. This is an outrage. I am not Mr. Brown.
That's precisely what Mr. Brown would say.
You caught Boris and Conrad while they were hanging around outside. They are in custody as we speak. Now, you and your men are coming down with us to the station. We have a lot of questions for you.
Get your filthy hands off me, you English swine! Do you know who I am? I am Kramenin! I'm an important person in my country!
Thank you for your help, Tommy. Now, if you come down to the station with me, I'll get these criminals locked up and get you your statement.
Of course. I told you you'd get what was coming to you. I'm just glad it was sooner rather than later.
Jane, Tuppence, you cannot believe that I'm Mr. Brown. I've been framed, I tell you. Framed!
Stay here with Sir James. He'll look after both of you. I just have to go down to the station for a little while. Then I'll be back and we can sort this whole mess out.
Tommy, I'm just so glad you're okay. There's so much I want to know. So much I want to say.
I know, and there'll be plenty of time for that later. But for right now, stay with Sir James. I'm sure he'll be happy to fill you in on what's really been going on with Mr. Brown.
It would be my pleasure, Tommy. Thank you. I'm glad to see you all right, Miss Finn.
The young adventurers take a lot of killing.
So it seems. But it appears that your joint venture with Mr. Beresford has ended in success. You have done what others before you could not do. You have found Jane Finn.
Yes, this is Jane Finn. She has quite a lot to tell you.
Perhaps when she is feeling stronger.
I must tell you now. It'll make me feel so much better if the lawyer knew my story.
Very well.
I came over on the Lusitania to take a post in Paris. I had been studying French and wanted to help in the war efforts. The French lessons would come in handy later, when you were playing the part of Annette. I'll get to that. When the Lusitania was torpedoed, a man came up to me and asked me to take charge of some papers that were vitally important to the Allies. I agreed.
So we were right about that. Danvers did hand the treaty over to you.
He did. On the lifeboats, a woman seemed to take particular interest in me. Her name was Rita Vandermeer. At first, I was grateful for her being so kind to me. But as time went on, I began to have a bad feeling about her. When I saw her talking to two strange men, I knew I had to find a way to protect those papers. How terrifying that must have been for you. Indeed. So I ripped open the oilskin packet, substituted a blank piece of paper, then sewed it back up again. That way, if anyone did manage to rob me of it, it wouldn't matter much. But then I had to think about what to do with the actual papers. What did you do? I smoothed them flat and laid them between two advertisement pages of a magazine I'd been carrying. Luckily for me, no one noticed a plain old magazine. So when I was eventually captured by Mrs. Vandermeer and the two scary-looking men, I was able to bring the magazine with me undisturbed.
You poor thing. Did Mrs. Vandermeer injure you in any way?
We had just gotten off the train in London when she offered to show me the quickest way to get into town. I agreed. Then she took me down a dark alley and hit me over the head. The next thing I knew, I woke up laying in a dirty bed in this very room. How terrible! When I awoke, I heard Mrs. Vandermeer and the others arguing. It seemed that they had opened up the oilskin packet and had found the blank pages. But what they didn't know was if I'd changed the papers or if Danvers had been carrying a dummy message. From inside this room, I overheard their plans to torture me until they found out what I knew.
You poor girl.
That's when I decided to pretend I lost my memory. If I succeeded in carrying out my bluff, I just might be saved. So I spoke only in French and never revealed anything. What a clever girl you are.
Yes, clever indeed. You fooled them for years and years, and all the while you knew exactly where the treaty was. In a magazine.
That's the thing. I was surprised to see that the magazine was still in my possession. I knew I needed to find a more permanent hiding spot for it as soon as possible, So I took down the picture from the wall, cut a small slit in the back of it, and hid the treaty inside the picture frame. And there it has remained all these years.
So, all this time, you have just remained here as a prisoner?
I hope that one day I'll be found and be able to return to my real life. But I saw no way of escape, and I could not risk being found out, for I surely would have been killed. So I took on the identity of Annette and became the housemaid here at the hideout of Mr. Brown and his associates.
Well, now you have been found, and you can return to your real life.
And I'm eternally grateful for that.
Well, I suppose there's only one thing left to do now, and that's to retrieve the treaty from its long-suffering hiding spot.
How exciting! Let's let Jane do the honors.
Yes, let's.
Here you go, Sir James.
I've got it, at last, the ill-fated treaty.
We have succeeded!
It was here that our young friend Jane was confined for so long. A truly sinister room. Notice the absence of windows and the thickness of the door. Whatever took place here would never be heard by the outside world.
That is true, Sir James. What is your point?
You sense danger, Miss Tuppence. And I believe Miss Finn does as well.
I do. I can't help it.
You feel... We all feel the presence of Mr. Brown. Is that correct?
Could he, perhaps, be here
in this house?
No, sweet Jane. In this very room.
What?
You see, I am Mr. Brown. I had you fooled. I had you all fooled. I am Sir James Peel Edgerton, celebrated lawyer and likely successor to the position of Prime Minister of Great Britain. I relished that title, but I relished the title of Mr. Brown even more. Mr. Brown, greatest criminal mastermind of the 20th century.
You have the treaty. You don't need this anymore. Let us go.
Neither of you will be leaving this room alive. You said just now that we had succeeded. Well, it is I who has succeeded. The treaty is mine.
You'll never get away with this.
Oh, really? Let me tell you how this is all going to go down. Sooner or later, the police will break in here and find three victims of Mr. Brown. You and Jane will be dead, and I will be wounded. Luckily, though, I will be able to describe how Mr. Brown viciously attacked us and made off with the treaty. Then I shall simply walk out of here with the treaty in my pocket. It's a perfect plan.
Not a perfect plan, since it in fact ends with you going to prison for a very long time.
What?
Come on, Sir James, or should I say Mr. Brown? You'll be coming with us down to the station.
No, this can't be happening. Mr. Brown can't be arrested. He's supposed to take over the world. Curse you, young adventurers. You don't want to mess with me, Inspector. I know my rights. I want a lawyer. Wait, I am a lawyer.
Tommy, Tuppence, I'll see you back at the station. Jane, you'll need to come with me so I can get your statement.
Sure thing, Mr. Carter.
Oh, in that case, I'll be coming with you. I have let too many years go by without my sweet Jane. I am not letting her out of my sight for another minute.
Tommy, I have so many questions. How did you get here so fast? Did you really think Julius was Mr. Brown? How did you know you could get here before Mr. Brown hurt me or Jane?
Questions. How about we say goodbye to this place? I'll tell you all about it on the way home. Besides, there's something I need to ask you.
What's that?
Jane, there are so many times during this whole mess that I thought I'd never find you.
I'm so glad you did, Julius. I've never been so happy in my entire life.
And you have made me the happiest man in the world when you agreed to marry me today.
What'll be?
We will start off with your finest pot of tea. Then we'll go with a sampling of some of your best appetizers and steak and lobster all around. We'll cap off the night with your finest desserts.
Very good, sir. A couple who is clearly rolling in money. Look at me.
Ah, Tommy, Tuppence, won't you join us?
Well, then I take it you're not still mad at me for thinking you were Mr. Brown?
Oh, of course not.
What I'm wondering, though, is how I came to believe that my Julius could be Mr. Brown.
Well, it all started when I heard of the death of Rita Vandermeer. You see, only Julius and Sir James were in the room when she died. Therefore, I knew it had to be one of them. Then, when a photograph of you fell out of his pocket, I was certain that he was Mr. Brown.
But why should that make you suspect him?
Because at the time, I only knew you as Annette, the housemaid at the hideout of Mr. Brown.
Ah, yes. Then, what made you change your mind and suspect Sir James?
Well, on my way over to Mr. Brown's hideout, I kept thinking about what Julius had told me before he left. He said that the Jane he saw in the hospital looked an awful lot like the nurse he saw with Whittington a few days before. I put that together with the fact that Sir James was right on the spot when the decoy Jane was brought to the hospital. Then it all just clicked. Sir James was Mr. Brown.
Then why did you leave us alone with him? We could have been killed!
You were never alone. Julius Carter and I were outside with Inspector Japp the entire time. I knew if Carter was going to believe it, he would have to catch Sir James red-handed. Sir James, a respected lawyer, and can talk his way out of anything. I needed to make sure he couldn't talk his way out of this. But rest assured, you were never in any type of danger. I would have given my own life before I let anything happen to you.
Oh, Tommy.
You two should just do like Jane and I and get married.
Too late, Julius. We already did.
Congratulations, you two.
I'm sorry I never answered your proposal, Julius, but I figured since we had found Tommy, it was off the table anyway.
You asked Tuppence to marry you?
That's a story for a different time.
I never would have let it happen anyway. Tuppence is my girl. She always has been.
Ah, there's the whole gang. Out celebrating your victory?
Something like that, Mr. Carter.
Well, it seems the Young Adventurers Limited is a success. You found Jane Finn, and Mr. Brown is behind bars. What's next for the crime-fighting duo?
Well, first things first, we're going on a honeymoon. And then after that, well, I suppose we'll be looking for the next case to work on.
Be sure and call me when you do, but do me one thing.
What's that?
Find some proper offices. It's really not a good idea to be discussing top secret information out in the open.
Sounds good to me. And I think I know just the place. What do you think, Tuppence? Will this make a fine home for the Young Adventurers Limited?
I think it's wonderful.
I'd like to propose a toast, to Tommy and Tuppence.
Tommy and Tuppence.
And to the Young Adventurers Limited.
The Young Adventurers Limited.
For coming. Hope you had a great time and enjoyed the show.
Yeah.
We'd like to welcome you to have cookies in the back with us. And there's going to be a donation box there if you feel led to donate. We'd also like to recognize our behind the stage crew. We have props. Aubrey. Yeah. And then we have Tay. Our director and assistant director, Ms. Peckendorf. And Sarah has a gift.